This morning, we're going to do a psalm, and we're going to look at Psalm 145. And as I was going through it, I noticed a number of things from the book of Romans that I think kind of give us a little bit of a transition or summary from our studies of the previous months. It's a psalm of David. He writes, "I extol you, my God, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and highly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wonderful works, I will meditate. Men shall speak of the power of your awesome acts, and I will tell of your greatness. They shall eagerly utter the memory of your abundant goodness and will shout joyfully of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and great in loving kindness. The Lord is good to all, and his mercies are over all his works. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and your godly ones shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power to make known to the sons of men your mighty acts and the glory of the majesty of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord sustains all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due time. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his deeds. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of those who fear him. He will also hear their cry and will save them. The Lord keeps all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless his holy name forever and ever." May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's pray. One of the first school books of colonial America was the New England Primer. I mentioned that some months ago in our study in the book of Romans. It was a textbook used to teach Puritan children to read. It taught the basics. It taught, for example, the ABCs. And it did so with pictures and acronyms followed by a brief statement of wisdom or Christian doctrine. For example, the letter A had a picture of Adam and Eve standing by the tree and the statement, "In Adam's fall, we sinned all." For B, there was a picture of the Bible and the rhyme, "Thy life to men, this book attend," and so on through the alphabet. It's clever, but it's also biblical because it followed a pattern found in some of the Psalms, and the one that we will look at this morning, Psalm 145. It's an acrostic psalm. There are eight of them in the book of Psalms. Generally, they are structured according to the order of the Hebrew alphabet. So the first line begins with the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, which is Aleph, and then the second verse begins with the second letter, which is Beit, and then the third line begins with the letter Gimel, and so on through the alphabet. If we could put it in English or Latin letters, the first word in verse 1 would begin with the letter A. Verse 2 would begin with a word beginning with B, and the third verse with C, and so on through to the end. Psalm 119 is the best known of the acrostic Psalms. It's also, as you know, the longest of the Psalms. The psalmist who wrote these took great skill to do that, to construct them. But they were not simply ingenious works of poetry. They were arranged to educate. Probably they were done as mnemonic devices to help people memorize the psalm, or they may have been a way of indicating completeness, that a subject was covered from A to Z. Psalm 145 is the last of the acrostic psalms, and it's also the last of David's psalms. It's about praising God. It's about worship. And David constructed the psalm to indicate that in his final psalm, he was giving the full range of worship. David was saying, in effect, here are the ABCs of worship, the basics of worship. Follow this guide and your worship will be complete. That certainly is the case, which makes this not only a brilliant psalm, but an eminently practical psalm, because it shows us how we are to glorify God in our prayers and hymns, which are worship. Now that is, to be even broader, that is our purpose in life. Do you think that? Do you think my purpose for life, my purpose for existence is to glorify God? Paul said that at the end of Romans 11, for from him and through him and to him are all things, to him be the glory forever. Amen. So here is our primer, so to speak, our elementary textbook on worship and really on life. It begins with David's stated purpose being to praise God. I will extol you, my God, O King. He says he will do that every day. He says he will do that throughout eternity, forever and ever. David was king of Israel. He was Israel's greatest king, but God was his king. And David confessed that in the first line of his psalm, which is both a statement of faith and a statement of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. That's what Solomon tells us right at the beginning of the book of Proverbs. Adam lacked that fear. He lacked that reverence, that trust, that obedience. He wanted to be king, so he rejected his king and he fell. And as we were reminded in that New England primer, and as we were reminded from our studies in the book of Romans, chapter 5, he took with him all mankind. In Adam's fall, we sinned all. David, in contrast, was in submission to the Lord. He was his king and king over all things. And he would praise him for that throughout this psalm. And beyond this psalm, he says, forever and ever, meaning for all eternity. This is what we're made for, to be to God's glory and give expression to his glory in our worship and our deeds. Really, our worship goes beyond the things we say or the things we sing. It goes to the things we do. And David explains this and states this systematically in the rest of the psalm. There is also emotion in this. There is a fervency in this psalm. We get a sense of that in the first two verses. I will extol you. I will bless your name. Every day I will bless you. I will praise. Now, I call this a textbook, a primer on worship, and I think that is the case. I think we are given a structure to worship here. We are given the subjects of worship in this psalm, but worship is instinctive. Worship is reflexive. It is the kind of thing that we experience when we see something magnificent. We see a beautiful vista, and we naturally express wonder at it. We go, wow, or we go, isn't that magnificent? We don't have to tell ourselves to do it. It arises naturally when we see something of majesty and beauty. And that's the case with worship. David has a glimpse of, a sense of who God is. And this is a natural expression for him. There is, I think, a fervency and emotion to, I will extol you. And so as we get a glimpse of who God is, we get a sense of his greatness, which David will extol. We too will do that. That's what we need. And if this was, in fact, David's final psalm, if time was running out on David, then he wanted to express this to God. He wanted to express his gratitude for all that the Lord had done for him and to express his amazement at the Lord's majesty. That's where he begins. He begins very broadly by declaring the Lord's greatness. He says in verse 3 that his greatness is unsearchable. There's no end to it. It is infinite. And it must be. If God is God, then he is infinite. He's eternal. There is no limit. There is no end to him and to his greatness and his glory, which really is a way of confessing that that David had taken on an impossible task. This was his feeble attempt to give God the glory that he deserved. And what mere mortal can do that? And yet David was not discouraged. He, in fact, was encouraged. God is infinite. And attempting to praise him for who he is, simply thinking on his greatness and the vastness of it, well, that in itself is edifying. That in itself is a cleansing experience. It puts things in perspective. It puts us and life in perspective. When man thinks of his own greatness, God's diminished in his mind, in our minds, because that's what we so often do, isn't it? We promote self. We exalt self. That's the natural thing for a person to do. But when we think on God's greatness, we really get a glimpse of that, then we dwindle in our estimation. So magnifying the Lord, worshiping him, is edifying because it is humbling. And that's important. That's a necessary thing because it reminds us of who we really are, that we are creatures. And it reminds us of our need of the Lord, of our responsibility to worship him, to bow before him, but of our total dependence upon him. We are dependent upon him for everything. And as we reflect upon him, we're reminded of that. So to confess that his greatness is unsearchable doesn't discourage worship. It simply shows how worthy God is of our worship, even though it is at best feeble. David knew that. At best, his worship was clumsy. Still, he couldn't help himself. He must, and we must, worship. So, again, he gives us a structure for worship. He praises God's greatness in verses 4 through 7 for his mighty acts. Those are countless, like the stars of the sky, which are among his mighty acts. David praised those in Psalm 19. The heavens are telling of the glory of God. And certainly when we think of the Lord's mighty acts, we think of the universe and its origin in God's word. He spoke things into existence, ex nihilo, out of nothing. When there was nothing, and for an eternity there was nothing, suddenly God spoke and these things became. And not only that, we learn more specifically about the triune God and that Christ holds all things together and he upholds all things by the word of his power. We're told that in Colossians 1:17, in him all things hold together. Everything is bound together and is sustained by the Lord Jesus Christ. And not only that, as the author of Hebrews says in chapter 1 and verse 3, he bears the ages along. He not only holds this universe together, he's carrying it along. He is creating time and history. That's greatness. And we get just a sense of that, of God's might, from his display of it in nature. Psalm 29 is similar to our psalm. In it, David pictures a storm forming out on the Mediterranean and rumbling across Lebanon and breaking the great cedars of that place. He describes the thunder as the voice of the Lord upon the waters. God is in the violent storm. Nature inspired David. It did Jonathan Edwards as well. He noted that before his conversion as a boy, he had been uncommonly terrified, those are his words, by thunderstorms. But afterward, after he had come to know Jesus Christ as his Savior, after he had become a new creature, it was completely different. They inspired sweet and glorious contemplations of my great and glorious God, he said. Stars and storms are among God's mighty acts of creation. But the Lord's greatest acts are his acts of salvation. And David must have had them in mind because he ends the stanza in verse 7 by praising God for his goodness. All men, he said, shall eagerly utter the memory of your abundant goodness and will shout joyfully of your righteousness. And that's more than power. That's more than creative power. That is saving power. And David had experienced that throughout his life. He sang about it throughout his psalms. He gave testimony to the Lord's deliverance of him many, many times. He was under continual threat from his youth to old age. David lived a life of great power and accomplishment, but it was a life of continual threats. And we know that from his youth as a shepherd, God saved him from the lion and the bear. He saved him from the giant and the enemy's armies, the Philistines. He saved him from his own king, Saul, who pursued him all over the wilderness. Saved him from his own son, Absalom. Saved him from his own sin with Bathsheba. David understood the Lord's goodness. He understood his redemption. He understood that it was personal. But David also thought of God's goodness for the nation. No doubt was thinking about it here, because this goodness and righteousness and redemption, salvation, was most wonderfully displayed in God's deliverance of Israel from slavery in Egypt. That is really the focal point, the defining event of Israel's history, and they were to continually look back to that deliverance and reflect on who they were and what God had done for them and what he had made them. A kingdom and priests. Well, he did it with miracles. What David calls wonderful works and the power of his awesome acts. And yet, for all that the Exodus was, it pointed to something greater. It pointed to the deliverance of Calvary. It pointed to the coming of David's Messiah and our Savior, the Son of God, who rescued us and raised us up by his own obedience and death. And David was looking to that here, I think, as the hope that he had, the hope of his greater son, the Messiah, who would be named Jesus because, as the angel told Joseph, he will save his people from their sins. And you may think, well, that's seeing a little bit more in here than I think is there. And yet, David, who wrote this, also wrote Psalm 110, which the Lord Jesus, on the day of questions, when the Herodians and the Sadducees and the Pharisees and the lawyers came with their questions to try to trip him up, finally has a question of his own, and he asks about that psalm. Who was David speaking of when he said, The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make thy enemies a footstool for thy feet. Who is on the throne next to the Father? Who was on the throne next to God Almighty? A divine person. And he was saying, that is me. And David, who wrote of that psalm, is speaking of his king here. I believe, no doubt, he is thinking of the Lord here, the one who would save him from his sins. Now the next verse, verses 8 and 9, define his goodness more specifically in terms of his grace. So the psalm moves from God's greatness to his goodness and now to his grace. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and great in loving kindness. The Lord is good to all, and his mercies are over all his works. That's what the Lord revealed about himself in Exodus chapter 34 and verse 6, when Moses had made this request, Lord, I want to see your glory. And we think of God's glory and the request there as a sound and light show of some kind. And no doubt the glory of God is that. He is an unapproachable light. But this is what Moses wanted to see, and yet no man can look upon God and live. And so God granted the request. He placed Moses in the cleft of the rock. He covered him with his hand, and then he caused his glory to pass by. But his glory was revealed not in what God showed, but in what he said. And as he passed by, he uttered words of grace and mercy, that he forgives iniquity, and that his wonderful works, his awesome works are that. His awesome acts are that he saves sinners. That's the glory that he was revealing to Moses. One of the major subjects in this psalm is God's goodness. He cares. He is merciful. Merciful to the most undeserving. And in the next verses, David praises him as the one who provides for us all. That is what God reveals about himself. And we can only know that by the fact that God does reveal that, reveals that through his word, reveals that in the Bible, reveals that here in this psalm. Martin Luther made the point, and I think this is an appropriate year to be quoting Martin Luther, since we're celebrating the 500th year of the Reformation, and we will do that on October 31st, which marks the moment when he began that great event of history by nailing his 95 theses on the chapel door of Wittenberg Castle. But because of that, I'd done some reading this year on Luther and his thoughts, and he made the point that man, by human reason, by natural reason, can know some things about God, he said. He can confess that God is, and the world around us, the heavens above us, give ample testimony to everyone that there is a God, that he exists. And Luther said that he's good and that he's generous. We see that in all the things that God gives, the fullness of God's goodness in nature. But human reason, he pointed out, cannot produce the sense of certainty, the certain knowledge that God really wants to help me, that God cares about me personally. Too much in our experience also speaks against that. If we're simply looking at nature and things, and you often hear that said, If God is good, why is there so much sorrow in the world? If God is good, why is there so much evil in the world? So Luther said, I can only have the certainty of anything about who God is, about his care for me, from God's word, from his special revelation, from the Bible. Now it's true, as Edward said, you get a sense of the majesty of God in a thunderstorm. But when the storm blows your house away, how do you know God cares? Well, we know that from the Bible. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 3, Paul calls the Lord the God of all comfort. That's what he reveals to us. And that's what we must know and what we must believe. That's why the Bible is so essential. Without it, we can only speculate about God. We can only speculate about reality, about the meaning and the purpose of life. We're cast upon the philosophers who all contradict themselves. We can have no certainty. This book is light. Psalm 36, verse 9, in your light we see light. In the light of the Word of God, we understand life and ourselves. And here, God reveals His unconditional love for His people, those David identifies in verse 10 as the Lord's godly ones, His saints, believers. They have the certainty of God's love and care. But it also reveals, as David says in verse 10, that the Lord is good to all. He's good even to those who don't repent. He's good to those who don't confess Him to be God and King. He is slow to anger. And in verses 9 through 13, David explains that this is the nature of His rule. This is the nature of His kingdom. That is one of the emphasis that we see here in the psalm. David speaks repeatedly of the Lord's kingdom. In fact, he speaks of it four times in verses 11, 12, and 13. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Now, this is what has been called the universal kingdom of God. It is His eternal rule over all things. It has never ceased to be. It has never been interrupted in time. His kingdom or rule is experienced in His providence and experienced every day in His control of persons and events, of individuals and nations, in the changes in nature and the course of history. That's providence, God governing everything through the events of life. The Lord is the creator of and ruler of space and time. The entire universe is the footstool of His feet. How foolish not to confess Him to be God and King, as David did here at the beginning of the psalm. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, would not do that. He could not see it. He was king of the capital of the world at that time, which was the capital of idolatry. But really, his worship was of himself. You get a sense of that when he stood one day on the roof of his palace and he surveyed his vast domain and said, "Is this not Babylon the Great, which I myself have built?" He took all the glory for himself. Self was his idol. Immediately after that boast, just as he is finishing it, God humbled him. You know the story in Daniel chapter 4. Turned him into a man who acted like an ox and was put out into the field. And he was there for 7 years. 7 years he was humbled. But then his mind returned to him. He came to his senses by the grace of God, and he looked up and he confessed that the Lord is God and King. His domain, he said, is an everlasting dominion, and His kingdom endures forever from generation to generation. That's praise and worship. That's Psalm 145 and verse 13. And it was true right there in dark Babylon. This verse is found in some surprising places. In the middle of Damascus, there's an old mosque, the Grand Mosque of Damascus. It was once a Christian church. Over the doorway, one of the doorways into the church, is the inscription, "Thy kingdom, O Christ, is an everlasting kingdom, and thy domain endureth throughout all generations." Psalm 145, verse 13. In a mosque where Christ is denied, the stones, as it were, cry out, "Christ's kingdom is everlasting." And long after Islam is gone, and it will be, just as Babylon and Rome and all the kingdoms of the world have either passed away or will pass away, God's kingdom will still stand. It is everlasting. Praise God. It is a present reality wherever we go on this globe, in the darkest places of the world, or way beyond, out into the solar system itself. He rules. He's sovereign over the entire universe. Christ's kingdom will be manifested in the future. Specifically, He will return. That's a promise. He will come. His feet will touch upon the Mount of Olives. He will rule and reign for 1,000 years, and then the eternal state will come. But the Lord's kingdom is now as well. He is ruling right now. He is ruling and sustaining everything from the galaxies and dark matter to the flowers of the field. And since He sustains it all, He provides for all faithfully. That's the next of God's attributes that David praises in verses 14 through 16, His faithfulness as our provider. He praises God for His greatness. He praises Him for His goodness. He praises Him for His grace, and now for His faithfulness. The Lord sustains all who fall and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to You, and You give them their food in due time. You open Your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. What a magnificent picture that gives of the Lord God as provider. He opens His hand, His great hand, and He feeds every living thing. You think of a shepherd feeding by hand a small lamb, or baby birds with their mouths wide open being fed by their mother. That's really that's from the Psalms, Psalm 81. Open your mouth wide and I will fill it, the Lord says. He does that for all of us. We plant and sow and reap. There is a science to good agriculture, but it's God's science, His laws for good farming. And in and behind it all is His power and His will to make it happen. Things grow because He wills it to happen. Every good thing given and every perfect gift is from above, James says, coming down from the Father of lights. And He is generous in what comes down from Him. That's indicated here with His open hand that feeds. In a universe full of utterly lifeless space, darkness and dead places, scientists are struggling to find life out there. But all they can find are dead planets, dead places. In a universe like that, this one blue planet is burgeoning with life. Enough plants and animals to feed billions and billions of people multiple times a day. That's God's gift. The Lord is good. He's the God of life. He is the sustainer and the giver of life. He promotes life. He provides for life. And He is faithful. That's what David is praising here. That's the reason Jesus can tell His disciples in Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, don't worry about your life. Be faithful. God feeds the birds, He will feed you. But as encouraging as all of that is, the first statement in verse 14 is especially encouraging. The Lord sustains all who fall and raises up those who are bowed down, or it can be translated bent. And you get a sense of people being bent down, weighed down by the cares of life or whatever is troubling. Derek Kidner calls this phrase, all who fall, unusually expressive. And he does that because it's actually in the present tense. And so we can translate it, all who are falling, in the process of falling. Kidner describes this part of the psalm as God's help for the inadequate. We don't like to think of ourselves like that. Don't call me inadequate. That's what we are. We're all dependent. And we all stumble and fall. That's all of us, dependent people. The Lord helps, and His help, David is saying, is timely. Right when we fall, in the process, He's there to catch us. He's faithful to do that. And he does that for us every day through his providence. Not only through his providence, but through people. I think I mentioned this last week when we spoke about the ministry and finishing up the book of Romans. And I quoted, I believe, Hebrews 12:12. I think I did that Wednesday night as well. It's a great verse to quote. Strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble. That's how God works oftentimes. He works providentially. He works through us. He works through his people to help one another, to give encouragement, to give guidance, to give help, whatever is needed. He works through you to bless him or her, whoever is bearing heavy burdens. Well, sometimes God doesn't catch us and we fall hard. It's not because God failed. He can't fail to do anything, and he can't fail to care for us. Again, we know that not altogether from experience, but from his word. Experiences may, in fact, deny that, but it's the way William Cooper put it very well in his hymn. Behind a frowning providence, he hides a smiling face. There's a reason for these things. God moves in a mysterious way, and sometimes it's not so mysterious. Sometimes hard things happen to test us. To make us depend upon him if we're not doing that, to show us our need, and always, I think, always to give others opportunity to minister to us and to one another. But the Lord's not dependent upon us. We are to do that, but we are often so inadequate, we simply fail one another. We aren't always faithful, but he always is. And I love that statement that Paul makes. Last letter that he wrote to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 4, he speaks of his experience there in Rome. He's been a prisoner for some time, and then he had to face trial. And he stood, it seems, before the emperor, before Nero himself. And he uttered some amazing words, I think. He said, all had deserted him. But the great apostle Paul, all of his friends had deserted him. But, he said, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me. And not only strengthened him, gave him great boldness so that he gave the gospel to those pagan Romans. He does that for us. He never forsakes us. David knew that. When there was hardly a step, he said, between him and death, God was there, always with him. David knew God's faithfulness from the Bible. He knew Exodus 34, verse 6, that God is great in loving kindness. He quotes it here in verse 8. We know the Lord from the scriptures, as I have said, but David's knowledge was also confirmed by experience. And God had shown himself faithful to David throughout his life in difficult times. He lifts us up when we fall. He catches us when we are falling. David had experienced that in his life. He had seen God's faithfulness in nature. He's written of that here in the psalm. He'd seen his faithfulness to feed and care for the animals daily. He'd seen his faithfulness in bringing the harvest consistently. God provides, David is saying. He is faithful to do that. He provides nourishment for all. And most importantly, he provides protection and hope and salvation for his people. He provides when we call to him. He's faithful to do that. He is righteous, David says in verse 17. He always does right. And he is near, David said, to all who call upon him. He answers. He answers prayer. He saves them, he says. And he will fulfill the desire of those who fear him. The Lord keeps all who love him. Those who love him do not love the world or the things of the world, and the world does not love them. The Lord told his disciples to expect that. The world shuns the saints. But do we really miss anything? Do we? The world is passing away. That's what John tells us. It is in the process right now of passing away. The Lord's kingdom, though, is an everlasting kingdom. What you do today for him, that lasts forever. It does not pass away. In the midst of this world, as we live for him, As we serve Him, He provides for us, He provides for all our needs, and He keeps us. He protects and preserves us. He keeps us faithful. He keeps us to that degree completely. The world can't give us that security and care for us and love for us that the Lord gives. He does that. He is that for all. Faithful and good because He is, as David said, righteous. And because He is righteous, He must deal with the wicked. That's what David says in verse 20. But all the wicked He will destroy. Now that's all that David has to say about the wicked in the 21 verses of this psalm. Just half a verse. But it says it all. Because He is righteous, He will cleanse the universe of evil. That's the hope we have. He will deal with all justly. But He keeps those who love and fear Him, all who trust in Him. God's people do that. They love and fear Him. And because they do, they cannot help but praise and worship Him for His greatness and His blessings to us. David said he would do that in the first verses, and now again in the final verse, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and all flesh will bless His holy name forever and ever. So ends David's contribution to the book of Psalms. It ends on a note of praise. And that is what David invites us to do. So may we learn the ABCs of worship in this psalm and worship Him for His majesty. Worship Him as our Maker, Provider, Protector, as King and King of the universe and Savior of His people. May God put that within our heart to do so. But you can only do that if you're one of His people, if you know Him, if you love and trust in Him. And you can only do that by believing in Him and believing in Jesus Christ as God's eternal Son who became a man. And becoming a man, He died for sinners. He died for the wicked, that the wicked might become righteous, that sinners might be saved, and all who put their trust in Him are. So if you're here without Christ, look to Him, trust in Him, and then may God help you and help all of us to worship Him in word and deed. Let's pray. Father, we do thank You for Your goodness. Thank You for this great psalm, of which we have simply scratched the surface, but there's so much here that reminds us of why You are worthy to be praised, and we do praise You, and we thank You most importantly that You, who are our Creator, are also our Savior. You sent Your Son to die for us. Thank You for that. Thank You for Him. It's in His name we pray. Amen. Well, I think most of you know we finished the book of Romans last week, and so we're sort of in between things. We have Easter Sunday next week. We'll have a special sermon for that before we begin the Gospel of Mark the next Sunday.